If I were to tell you your boss was reading your emails, monitoring your browser, tracking your movements during the workday, you might swiftly close some tabs, but you probably wouldn't be that surprised. Apparently, more than half of us think that we're being watched at work. We are, and we always have been. People talk about workplace surveillance as if it's something out of a Philip K. Dick novel. Workplace surveillance has a long history. In America, Black Studies professor Simone Brown traces the relationship to slavery, plantation overseers, slave patrols, New York City lantern laws that required slaves to carry candles with them after dark. Meanwhile, in Britain, the transition from workshop to factory production during the Industrial Revolution was enabling bosses to surveil workers way more easily, using things like punch cards and panoptic architecture. By the 20th century, the French philosopher Michel Foucault had come to the conclusion that surveillance was symptomatic not just of the modern workplace, but of modernity itself. But then why do things seem to have got so much worse this past year? It can't just be that we're all stuck at home doomscrolling. It might be to do with the fact that we're all stuck at home, though. Before the pandemic, the main way employers assuaged their anxiety about what workers got up to was presenteeism, gently nudging or contractually obliging us to be physically present with them in the office. The sneaking suspicion of bosses everywhere is that when we work from home, what we're really doing is sitting in bed watching Netflix. And to be fair, we probably are doing some of that. But the thing is, we're still more productive. In a recent survey by the University of Essex, workers reported being just as industrious at home as at the office, even with all the pressures of the pandemic. But that doesn't stop bosses treating remote workers with suspicion, suspicion they satisfy with intensified surveillance. A few months ago, you could dial into a meeting or turn off your Slack notifications, no problem, but now you're suddenly being sent PASSAG messages if you're off Slack for more than a few minutes, or being made to turn on your camera during a Zoom call. At the techier end, there's software called things like Sneak, Clever Control, Spy Agent, and Staff Cop, offering things like invisible installation and silent screenshots, software that sells itself on covertness and is way more prevalent than you might think.
Worker surveillance, employee monitoring, spying, whatever you want to call it, we've seen a massive increase during the course of the pandemic. The latest data shows that long-term surveillance tools are seeing an increase of about 51%. It's also become more covert. Employees don't really know their rights around employee surveillance, and that's a big barrier to making sure that the worker-employee contract works well.
That isn't to say there hasn't been resistance to surveillance until now. Enter surveillance. Surveillance, coined by the Canadian engineer Steve Mann in the early 2000s, refers to the act of identifying and counteracting surveillance. It's what Simone Brown calls citizen undersight, and means watching the watchers, either to hold them to account or simply to escape their control.
There are ways to get around that. Your employees will just install fake webcam software, or they can write macros to imitate typing or mouse movement, or they can spoof their location. So it's an ongoing war of attrition which benefits nobody.
Surveillance is great, but probably not a long-term solution. What we need is for employers to do the right thing, or rather, be made to do the right thing.
Workers already have quite a few protections under the Data Protection Act 2018 in the UK. So firstly, the contents of that act, which is based off GDPR, because it is the British implementation of GDPR, gives workers certain rights. So you can demand to your employer, for example, what data they hold on you and why they need it. And they have to show that it's proportional and necessary.
Employers have been pretty cavalier in their approach to GDPR. In fact, many are flagrantly breaching it. Unions have made some positive noises about surveillance, but they haven't made much of a concerted effort to empower workers to defend their rights on surveillance or to force bosses to fulfill their obligations. UTAW, or United Tech and Allied Workers, hopes to change that.
So UTAW, United Tech and Allied Workers, represent a lot of software engineers. We have people who are very, very aware of these things. There's a lot going on nowadays with community organization, especially tech-savvy bodies such as UTAW. Then the question naturally turns to, what protections do we have? What legal rights do we have that we can force them to stop some of this? On the legal aspect, there is the matter of keeping track of what the government is doing with regards to the Data Protection Act, and looking at ways where if we identify a need for workers to have further protection, we need to lobby Parliament to change that, make those changes.
Look, I don't think surveillance, even the more technical kind, is bad in itself. No technology is. The problem is when surveillance is excessive, punitive, and opaque. Many employers are actively deceiving their employees, but many more are just relying on our ignorance, apathy, and fear to commit daylight robbery of our data. What's worse, this situation doesn't even really help bosses. It erodes trust, wrecks productivity, and is a massive waste of money. It's time workers told them. Leave us alone, you weirdos.